givest us free. Give us free.
Your Honor, please instruct the defendant that he cannot disrupt these proceedings with such outcome.
Give us free!
If we are to have any semblance of order in this case,
give us
peace, unity, and welcome my conscious and unconscious family and friends. This is the all-new Black Village Community Podcast, and I am truly your host of the show, JC, a.k.a. Afro Black, dropping nothing but the raw and uncut. Without any fear, as I use my mic as a spear to chucka-chucka you with liberated truth, I am your host and your native soldier in the struggle. My purpose and mission for this show is first to enlighten, inform, and engage. And I want to engage with all who claim to know the truth. All truth seekers and my native family, I welcome you. This show is dedicated to all our indigenous native ancestors and to all those who've carried the mantle of truth and to every person with the ability to throw off the chains of comfortable habit and unwarranted assumption and move in a new, liberated direction that is guided by truth and observational evidence, no matter where that direction may lead you. My main objective and purpose here is freedom, mind, soul, and spirit. That being said, welcome to the Black Village Community Podcast and much love from our great universal goddess and mother of all living here and above.
AC in the house.
Have us ever. You know, because I mean, we know for a long time they haven't.
You don't do a dog like that. You didn't have to shoot him 8 times. If he was doing something to you and you was trying to stop him, where did the police shoot you? In the leg. You just shot off through my baby body.
Did the boy do anything wrong?
They say he supposed to shoot somebody quick trip. I don't care. He ain't have no gun. He threw his hands up. When the police man on his feet.
Yeah.
The boy threw his hands up.
Yeah.
Let's go. Born with a target enlarged in my flesh. Can't call the law for defense. My defense corner the black market while armed with a tech. Guilty until we pay for innocence. So innocence. My offense was nothing but being born. Who gave me the right to take breath? My eyes can't hide the pain. Though my smiles as I protect. Systemized to believe it's the way it's supposed to be. How things were meant. No. Curiosity sparked the thought of illumination for change. All these accepted atrocities fill my generation with rage. Envisioning being murdered while Illmatic is playing. You never hear an Illinois to neck. I go get the spray and it's ill logic. I spit with these ill toxins. I sip till I'm bit and call a chick with that ill nine to take me over a cliff. And we fall but we split. Cause real love will mean we would hit the bottom together. So we just fall apart. Cause bad bitches want the most ball. And these fellas can get their hair wet. Won't endure all of the weather. No umbrellas, no sun shining. About whatever to keep my son smiling.
Hey, this is JC, a.k.a. Afro Black, and I am here with you for another delicious Black Sunday, dropping nothing but the raw and uncut here on the Black Village Community Podcast. And let me let my conscious community go know that there is still a hacking asshole out there that's still pinging my show. But, you know, this show must go on, despite the pinkster, you feel me? So I'm still going to do the best I can, as much as I can, to say what I need to say on the issues. You feel me? On the conscious issues. And today's podcast subject matter is titled A Revolutionary Warrior and Activist. brother Darren Seals. I'm going to give honor to our fallen brother and soldier brother Darren Seals. Much love and respect to the brother. And so on that note, I must venerate the brother. I must talk about the brother. I must share with the brother what I've researched and what I know about the brother. I didn't know him personally, but due to the fact that he was a soldier for the conscious movement, he was a soldier for the activist movement, due to the fact that he was a young brother and a young soldier and a strong revolutionary soldier who stood for what was right. When he was in the streets, he was a soldier for the streets. When he became a soldier for truth, a soldier for activism, a soldier for his people, he was a true revolutionary soldier. So on that note, you might say, well, if you don't know the brother, how do you know this? Well, based on the fact of his reputation, based on the things that he's done, based on what other people had to say about him, the brother sounded like a very sound, strong brother, a conscious brother who stood for truth, stood for his community, stood for what was right, fought against police brutality, fought against injustice, stood up for what was right on behalf of black people. And so on that note, the brother deserves to be honored. The brother deserves recognition. You feel me? And so on that note, that's what I'm going to do today. I want to talk about brother Darren Seals. So let me change up my sounds, change up my music, give us something more, something laid back to talk about, to reverberate on. Yeah, I think that right there should do it, because to me, brother Darren Seals walked like a warrior. So that's why I decided to play Dead Prez, Walk Like a Warrior. So on that note, I got my queen here with me to verbrate and to share her thoughts on this brother. Queen, go ahead and holler at the community.
Hello, my beautiful people.
And so, Queen, you see why, let me turn this down, turn down the warrior music a little bit so it's sitting in the backdrop while we verbrate. Okay, so, I'm not sure what you know about the brother. I've shared some stuff. I've shared some things with you that I've learned about the brother, about him being an activist, about him being a brother that was for the people, who was there on the scene when Michael Brown was killed, and it changed his life. It gave him something to fight for, gave him something to stand up for, due to the fact that he was from that town, Ferguson. That was his town. That's where he grew up at. What I've learned from him, that he was a hard-working brother who worked for General Motors on the assembly line, and he was also an activist, and he was also a rapper. And so these are some of the things that I've learned about the brother. Due to the fact that he was the first one on the scene, and he was the one that that helped organize the protest in Ferguson, that helped bring light to the injustice and the police brutality in Ferguson. And as I did my research, I noticed I kept seeing that people kept connecting him to Black Lives Matter, which he was not a part of Black Lives Matter. That was not a part of, that had nothing to do with him. He had something to do with them coming down there due to the fact that he brought attention to what was going on in Ferguson, but he was not a part of that movement, you know. But actually, the movement that he started, I noticed that the media is not giving him credit for, which was Hands Up, Don't Shoot. That was something that Darren Seals started, something that he has something to do with. And I noticed that, you know, they kind of shroud that in mystery, like nobody knows who was behind that. So, Queen, what do you have to say so far?
Well, basically from the things that you have told me about him and what I've seen from his YouTube videos, he had, you know, he admitted that his life didn't start out all that great, and he was involved in, you know, gang activity, and had made poor choices and made a decision to change that life. And when he made that decision to change his life and he got back on his feet, he decided to help others do the same. And when he saw what happened there in Ferguson, he decided that was, you know, there was a cause that was calling him.
Exactly. And you know what? I mean, that's profound in itself. I mean, would you agree?
Absolutely.
I mean, you got a lot of brothers that get caught up in the gang violence, get caught up in the drug scene, get caught up in the hustling and the grinding and you know, anything of that sort. And they get stuck in that cycle and they don't know how to get out of it, you know, because it's fast money. You know, it's a lifestyle. It's a mindset. And they get stuck in that and they don't know how to get out of it. I've known brothers that just admitted to me, brothers I grew up with, brothers I knew, who just said, hey, you know, Jay, I don't know how to get out of this. You know, I'm stuck. So, but to see that this brother came out of it and decided to be a positive influence, a positive impact on his community, man, that's a wonderful, that's something to aspire to. That's something to you know, there's a reason why this brother should be venerated. You feel me? I don't want to really focus on his death. I mean, I'm going to share some of, you know, share a little bit of that, but I'm not going to make that main focus. To me, my main focus is to, you know, to talk about the brother in a positive perspective, because that's what he did. He did things in a positive perspective. And as a result of that, anybody who did not come on that level, but yet was acting or fronting or portraying themselves as something that they weren't, he had no respect for that individual. And you know what? That's also the side. That's a revolutionary soldier side of him. Soldiers respect those who are real. You feel me? No matter what direction you come in, as long as you come in correct, as long as you come in 100, as long as you being real, as long as you being 100. But when you being faulty, when you being fake, when you being phony, soldiers don't respect that. You feel me? When I was in the streets, brothers I knew, they didn't respect brothers or respect sisters who was faulty, who was phony, who was fake. They couldn't stand those type of people. That was a quick way to get what they call beat slapped. You feel me? That was a quick way to get you come in faulty. You say one thing out of one side of your mouth and then say another, you know, or you acting like something that you're not. That was a quick way to get beat slapped, or a quick way to get chin checked, or a quick way to get jacked. You know, take everything you got, man. Nigga, give me your money. Give me your wallet, nigga. Nigga, nigga, break yourself, nigga. That was a quick way to get jacked. You feel me? Because you come in faulty. You're not a street nigga. You just out there trying to be somebody that be something that you're not. You know, I knew brothers in the street that would tell a young brother, slap their brother, take everything you got, and go to school and go get a book. You know, so he was a real brother. And bottom line, to be upfront about it, he was a real brother. He was a good brother. He was he was committed to the cause and committed to his people. So on that note, what I would like to read first, before I, you know, matter of fact, before I read anything, I didn't want to focus on his death, but I want to play a little something for those who are not privy or maybe didn't hear about it. So, you know, didn't hear the details of it or hear anything. Let me play this right quick, and then we shall take it from there.
One of Ferguson, Missouri's well-known black activists has died. We told you this on yesterday. 29-year-old Darren Seals found shot to death in a burning car on Tuesday in St. Louis. He was one of the leaders of the Ferguson protest after the killing of Mike Brown by a white police officer in 2014. In fact, Seals was one of the first activists who was on the scene shortly after Mike Brown was killed. He stood with and comforted the Brown family as they received word that a grand jury declined to indict former officer Darren Wilson in Brown's death. Seals, who was also a rap artist, frequently tweeted about racism, police violence, and politics. Just weeks before his death, he described this encounter with police in a tweet saying, quote, "Two detectives pulled me and my 14-year-old brother over, pointed guns on us, and told me to choose your enemies wisely." What's even more disturbing is that Darren Seals is the sixth black man in Ferguson to be found shot to death in a torched car in the last 2 years. Joining me via FaceTime from St. Louis is Carlos Bell, a close friend of Darren Seals. On the phone from St. Louis, one of Seals' fellow activists, Tef Poe. Tef, I want to start with you. Obviously, a lot more questions than we have answers in the death of Darren Seals.
I think the community don't have too many questions. I think the community is clear on what's going on here. I think that, you know, from my perspective, Seals was clearly set up. This is I don't even call it a killing, a murder. Darren Seals was assassinated by somebody. Darren Seals was assassinated by somebody.
There you go right there. You heard Tef Poe, who was also a friend of Darren Seals, who was also a rapper. I'm not sure if I mentioned that the brother was on top of him being an activist and a hard worker and a soldier for his people in the community. He was also, Darren Seals was a rapper. He was an artist, you know. He was called King D, you know, or they called him King, you know. And so I'm going to play some of his, actually the music that you heard
in the beginning of the show, if anybody, you know, if anybody caught the beginning of the show, the intro to the show, that music, that rapper, that was DOA, which was a music video with some artists from the Ferguson area that Darren Seals put together. And so that was by them, you feel me? And you can go check that on YouTube. But I got some other music I want to play. He also was getting ready to come out with a group called Bottom Boys. That was another group that Darren Seals put together and that he was promoting. And they was actually working on a record deal prior to his assassination, you feel me? And like Tef Poe said, I wouldn't call it a murder. I wouldn't call it one either. It was an assassination on a brother who was a soldier for his people. You know, actually, when you listen to Darren Seals, if you go to YouTube and listen to any of his videos that he put up, you know, the brother sound, I mean, he just reminds me. He doesn't sound like Tupac because him and Tupac don't have the same style and flavor, but he reminds me of Tupac in the essence of that soldier spirit, that revolutionary spirit for his people. Can you feel me on that, Queen?
Yeah, absolutely. He does have that, you know, that awareness, that revolutionary spirit, that soldier voice.
Exactly. And so, you know, that draws attention. So I'd like for us to read this article right here, which is by Heavy.com. Darren Seals found it. Five Facts You Need to Know. Okay, it's called Five Facts You Need to Know. About brother Darren Seal. Okay. So if you can read that, Queen, that'd be hella cool. Hella cool.
All right, reads, a prominent activist during the protests in Ferguson following the police shooting of Michael Brown was found dead Tuesday morning in a burning car, police say. The death of Darren Seals, 29, is being investigated as a homicide, the St. Louis Post-Dispatch reports. Here's what you need to know. 1. Seals was shot before the vehicle was set on fire, police say. Darren Seals was found about 1:50 a.m. in the 9600 block of Diamond Drive in Riverview, St. Louis County Police told the St. Louis American he suffered a gunshot wound before the vehicle was set on fire, according to police. The shooting remains under investigation and no suspects are in custody. Police said no information about a possible suspect or a motive for release. The car was still on fire when police found it, according to the St. Louis Post-Dispatch. The flames had been exhausted before Seals' body was found, the newspapers report. The St. Louis County Police Bureau of Crimes Against Persons and its Bomb and Arson Unit are investigating. Anyone with information is asked to call Crime Stoppers at 1-866-371-8477 or the police at 314-615-5400. 2. He was near the scene of the Michael Brown shooting and was vocal during the protests that followed. Seals became active in the protest after Michael Brown's death and said he was near the scene of the 2014 shooting in Ferguson. It wasn't even a protest yet, he told The Nation. It was a black boy being shot in the community. It was about 10 other women and men out there and the family. Before it became a riot, before it became a protest, it was just the community coming together. Seals spoke often to the national media and co-founded a group called Hands Up United. He was also with Brown's mother on the night it was announced a grand jury had declined to indict former police officer Darren Wilson in the shooting.
Now, you notice it said that he created the organization Hands Up United.
Yeah.
So that the slogan that became Hands Up, Don't Shoot, his organization, him, that was a slogan that they started. Yet, when you go on the internet, the media does not connect it to him at all. And the media keep trying to connect him to Black Lives Matter. Darren Seals had nothing to do with the organization Black Lives Matter. He was not a member of Black Lives Matter. Now, he knew the organization. He knew the founding members due to the fact of the media coverage on Ferguson due to Michael Brown's death and Black Lives Matter wanting to get involved with what he was doing down there. So he allowed them to come down there. He worked with them to come down there to make the protest, to continue the protest and to make it larger and to bring attention. So, but he had issues with Black Lives Matter, and we can go into that a little later. But go ahead, continue, please, Queen.
And for Mike Brown's mother to be right there in my arms crying, she literally cried in my arms. It was like I felt her soul crying. It's a different type of crying. I've seen people crying, but she was really hurt, and it hurt me. It hurt all of us, he told MTV News. I don't recall anyone having a longer protest or a more productive protest or a more creative protest than what we did. I don't think people will ever really appreciate what we did until years from now. We really did the best we could. 3. He was a musician and worked on an assembly line at a factory. Seals was a hip-hop musician and worked on an assembly line at a General Motors plant, according to Al Jazeera America. He was part of a hip-hop group called the Bottom Boys Movement. Seals, who went by King D. Seals on social media, called himself a businessman, revolutionary, activist, unapologetically Black, African, and American KKK fighter and leader on his Twitter page. He often spoke about police brutality and other issues in social media.
Wow.
Seals spoke often about social justice issues, including police brutality, and was critical of groups including Black Lives Matter, which he considered to be outsiders who came into the Ferguson community.
Wow. But you know what? Talking about the Bottom Boys, a group that he created, I got a track. I want to, like I say, this podcast is dedicated in memory of Brother Darren Seals, and so I got the video that he put together. He's in the music video. The video is called "Can't Go" or "I Can't Go." That's what the video is called. That's what the song is called. That's what the rap is called that the group did. And this was his group that he put together. It was a group that he was promoting and managing. And also they were in the process, prior to his assassination, they were in the process of getting a record deal. They were actually working with a record company. And so I would like to play a little bit from that track of the Bottom Boys and Darren Seals. But in his group that he put together. So let me play that and we will continue with the 5 facts. I think there's like 2 facts left. So we will continue from there.
I can't go even no niggas who will snake you for your phone money. He's supposed to be your pro, but I can't go. Shave my head 2 times on it. Cause life ain't got no rewind on it. No need to waste time on it. Stack, pray, stay out the way, run a track up. Stay with that AK, don't let up. I be on the drugs, no love in the city of thugs. Gotta thank my God every day I wake up, cause I ain't got here with the plug. Yeah, that shit can get so wicked. Watch your homeboys and watch the ones you kick with. That shit can get ridiculous. Fell out over hoes, no niggas who got back dope. For the bro, I can't go. Even no niggas who would snake you for your pole. He's supposed to be your bro, but I can't go. Niggas supposed to be my bro. He finessed me for a bro, but never again. I'll never again. I'll never again. Cause I can't.
can't cope. I'm riding with 30s, them bitches is twins, them bitches is thin. If I say so, these niggas they grin, all they my skin, and that's why I can't trust the soap. Man, these niggas still ain't learned, so I'm gon' show they ass the rope. Got choppers, don't need no coke. Got money, don't need no hoes. These switches need to be rolled, and I can't go, and I can't go. Taking these bills, ain't taking the wheel for all of my niggas, are poor before. But all of my niggas are poor before.
I poor before, I poor before.
And rest in peace to bro. We gon' open up that door.
And we gon' blow it. And we gon' blow
it. There you go, that's Darren Steele's group, Bottom Boys. Title of the cut is I Can't Go. And, you know, as you can tell, the brother, you know, he was talented. He knew talent when he heard it. He knew talent when he seen it. And, you know, he put this group together. He managed this group. And then they were getting ready to come out with something. They were getting something was in the works, you know. You can go online and you can check out the video. It's called Bottom Boys. Can't Go, check it out. So as well as another video, you know, I played at the beginning of my show, the group called DOA. That was something Darren Steele put together too by a bunch of young brothers from the neighborhood. And it was called Born Target. Matter of fact, Young Noble from The Outlaws is in the video, is a part of that as well. So let me change my tone here, and we shall continue this. Yeah, so as I said, that's right there. That's Bottom Boys, brother Darren Seals. May he rest in peace. He's with the, walking with the ancestors. You feel me? But the brother was a soldier. He was a soldier. He kept himself busy, and you know, he had a heart for the young people. He had a heart for young brothers, reaching out to young brothers. And so, matter of fact, you know, but I got another audio cast I want to play. And this audio cast that I want to play, it's Brother Darren Seals speaking. But before I play that audio cast, I want to continue what my queen was reading about five facts about Brother Darren Seals. Go ahead and continue that, queen.
Alrighty, continues to say, Seals also spoke about how politicians, including local Democrats and President Barack, hadn't done enough to fix the issues affecting the black community. To this day, in 7 or 8 years, we haven't seen any significant difference in the black community, he told the Washington Post on October 2014. In fact, it feels like it's getting worse. He voted for a Republican in St. Louis County executive race that year. Just because they've got the D next to their name, that don't mean nothing. The world is watching us right now. It's time to send a message of our power, Seals told the Post. We aren't asking you to perform miracles. We just want you to do the job you were supposed to do. Number 5. Many have mourned his death on social media, saying he practiced what he preached. Fellow activists and others in the St. Louis area community have mourned the loss of Seals on social media, with one person saying he always practiced what he preached. You can see some of their tributes below. One gentleman says, "We can live in a world where people don't die by violence. Nobody deserves to die. We did not always agree, but he should be alive today."
And that was the brother who posted that tweet. Is D. Ray McKesson. Why you pronounce his last name, Queen?
McKesson.
That's the one that he actually beat. That brother Darren Seals beat slapped. You know, because the brother was using Ferguson to bring popularity and attention to himself as a platform to further his career, and that was not cool. You know, Brother Seals did not respect that. You know, he didn't see that as respecting the family. And so, you know, so, but even though him and D-Ray didn't agree, the brother respect, obviously D-Ray respect Brother Darren Seals. You see, he said, you know, by him making that statement right there. And so there's other people who are making statements as well. Like one right here says, "Peace to the family and friends through this time of mourning and grief." And So you got a lot of people saying things on here. But let me also I got this audio cast I want to play. This is Brother Darren Seals. This is an audio cast that was posted by Brother Darren Seals before his passing. And so I want to play this. And these are his words. These are his thoughts about the movement and about what was going on at the time. You feel me? So let's continue. This is, like I say, this show is dedicated in the memory and loving memory and loss of Brother Darren Seals, a revolutionary soldier for the movement, for the struggle. Number love and peace for that brother. You feel me? So let's play this here, and we shall continue our discussion.
Where the fuck y'all come from? Where all this fake love come from? You know what I mean? If you weren't here before the media, I ain't take you serious. I don't give a fuck who you was. Tyler Kweli, any of the other motherfuckers. I really ain't take none of them serious, because at the end of the day, y'all came because of the media. End of story. The CNN ain't show up. None of them motherfuckers would have cared about Mike Brown. So I really wasn't tripping off the shit they was doing. But I just noticed, like, man, these cats is really building a whole fucking campaign off our shit and soliciting all these funds off our shit. And then black folks, you know, we ignorant to a lot of this type of shit because we ain't into that. So when they started the hashtag Black Lives Matter, it was so catchy that everybody shared it, everybody started saying it, and it became so fucking big, so large. People actually thought, like, oh, this is just a catchy hashtag. But people didn't know it. This was actually an organization. The founding members are three lesbian girls. D-Ray, the girls, Brittany Alexis, the dude Charles Wade. All the people that's involved in this whole little, in the forefront of this whole Black Lives Matter Campaign Zero shit, they all gay. It's like a gay cop. So they're using this shit, they're using their sexuality for protection. Because you know the white folk, they're going to protect you when you're gay. They fuck with you when you're gay. So they soliciting all these funds, doing all this fraud shit, and they're using the fact they're gay as a shield. So you really can't say shit about them, because when you do, they come for your neck. They stick together, you know what I mean? All of them eating off Mike Brown death, though. Now they traveling. D-Ray, he go to Yale. They give him like 40 bands to go to Yale and speak. They got him as the face of Ferguson. He ain't even from this motherfucker. Never even been in this motherfucker until Mike Brown died. Dude from Baltimore. And they ran him up out of there. Now he down here, the face of Ferguson, the face of the movement. They calling him the next Malcolm X. That's a fucking insult. Malcolm X wouldn't even respect that man, let alone be anything like him. But anyways. So you got the Black Lives Matter shit. It's blowing up. And if you notice, as it's blowing up, you're not hearing about Mike Brown anymore. You're not hearing about Darren Wilson anymore. You're not hearing about the Ferguson Police Department anymore. We're not hearing about none of this corrupt shit by McCullen, Jay Nixon. You're not hearing about none of this shit no more. All you're hearing about is Black Lives Matter now. They took the energy away from Ferguson. But they did it so intelligently, a lot of people didn't understand what was going on when it was going on. So they was helping these motherfuckers. Not even knowing, they stealing our shit. A lot of cats went to jail for us to be the main topic in the media. A lot of cats risked their life. Spook got shot in the head. She could be dead right now. You know what I mean? A lot of shit happened for this shit to grow into what it became. There was an opportunity to really fight back and really make a change in Ferguson and Missouri as a whole. But as you see, nobody was indicted. Most of the people that was in office still in office, and nothing really happened. They just clearly got away with murder. Nothing happened.
There you go. That was Brother Darren Seals, and that was his voice. That was an upload he uploaded onto YouTube, explaining his thoughts on the movement. And as you heard him say, you know, he didn't have very good words. I didn't hear any good words about Black Lives Matter. He more or less talked about Black Lives Matter from the perspective that they were using the publicity of young black men being killed to further their own agenda. And if that's the case, I got no respect for those broads. I got no respect for Black Lives Matter. They're a bunch of phonies, a bunch of fakes, a bunch of house Negroes. a bunch of elitist house Negroes. You feel me? And so I feel the brother on that level. That's why I say Darren Wilson was a soldier. He was a revolutionary soldier. He was a conscious soldier. You feel me? I got nothing but love for that brother, man. Nothing but love, and a loss when you think about it. You feel me? Because he was going into the music industry. He was very talented, as you can hear. You hear me play some of his music. The Bottom Boys, they were tight. They were some tight brothers, man. They had skills, you know, on the microphone. So, you know, and they had an ear for music. You feel me? So, due to the fact that he was breaking into the music industry, he was a hardworking brother. He was an intelligent brother who knew how to express and articulate himself. You feel me? And he was definitely raw and uncut about it. You feel me? And due to the fact that he was he was a brother who was from the gutter, who worked his way out of the gutter. You feel me? Obviously the people in the struggle, these people shouldn't even be in the struggle. You feel me? They shouldn't even be in the movement. At least they shouldn't be in the forefront of the movement. They're a bunch of cowards. They're a bunch of manipulators. They're a bunch of liars. If they're using the death of unarmed black people to further their own agenda rather than basically trying to make a change, rather than basically trying to, you know, resurrect something positive out of this for the benefit of the community. But if they're doing it for a selfish, something is wrong. You feel me? So I got another audio cast that I want to play. I didn't want to play too much because, you know, there was a lot of audio footage of Brother Darren, you know, speaking his mind. You feel me? So, you know, I only got an hour, you know, from 3 to 4, so I only can go for so long. So, but I got another audio cast that I want to play of the brother dropping the raw and uncut. And as I said, you know, the brother was true. He was true to the cause. And, on that note, I got nothing but love and respect for the brother. But before I read that, before I play that audio cast of the brother, I got another article I want to read. And this article is titled, Meet Darren Seals. Then tell me Black Death is not a business. And the reason why this article is important is because it speaks to the message that he was trying to convey, that you got a lot of people out there that are nothing but hustlers and who are using the fact that black people around this country are being assassinated and brutalized by cops, and they're using it as an opportunity to further their own personal financial agenda. You feel me? And so I want to Queen, are you there to can you read you got that article?
Yeah, I do.
Well, can you read that, please?
Alright, it says, this Ferguson protester and local activist was found murdered in St. Louis last month. To the end, Darren Seals continued to call out those who exploited black suffering for their own benefit, something that didn't always win him friends. A portrait of a city's pain and a life cut short. Meet Darren Seals. Then tell me Black Death is not a business. On September 6, 2016, Darren Seals, a Ferguson protester and local activist, was found dead in St. Louis Riverview Municipality in a car that had been set on fire. He had been shot to death before the car was torched. The crime is being investigated by St. Louis police as a homicide. There have been no arrests. Seals was 29 years old. Do you know who Darren Seals is? Maybe you do. Since his murder quickly became international news, covered by the very media outlets which, in life, he chastised for ignoring him, and the other St. Louis protesters whose activity did not stop after the cameras left town. Did you know who Darren Seals was before he died? If you live in St. Louis and were involved in the Ferguson protests, you did. On Facebook and on Twitter, Seals had been criticizing the co-option of Ferguson activism since late 2014, detailing an international division between the Ferguson movement and the National Civil Rights Movement known as Black Lives Matter. At the heart of this division, wrote Seals, was the exploitation of black pain for profit, conducted not only by white media and NGOs, but by out-of-town black elites who seized on Ferguson as a stepping stone to glory.
Let me also mention that NGOs stand for nonprofit organizations. So there was a lot of nonprofit organizations that were coming out to Ferguson to basically benefit from the attention in the media. And so this was an issue with Brother Darren Seals, that he saw that they were basically using it for their self, their own personal agenda. Continue, Queen.
In a May 24th, 2015 post written in his typically blunt style, Seals excoriated what he saw as the hijacking of Ferguson and the complicity that lies in silence. Black death is a business, he wrote. Millions and millions flowing through the hands of these organizations in the name of Mike Brown, yet we don't see any of it coming in our community or being used to help our youth. I've been calling out this shit for months. People see this as an opportunity not to only build a name, but make bank at the expense of the lives of people like me. This is why you should know Darren Seals, if you didn't. He was among few writers to clearly call out the division between the activists of the St. Louis region and the broader Black Lives Matter movement. In St. Louis, this division is talked about on the ground, but rarely publicly. In the white-dominated mainstream media, where Ferguson is primarily spoken of as a symbol rather than a place where actual people live and suffer and fight, the fractiousness between local and national Black movements has gone largely uncovered. Having abandoned Ferguson as a place while embracing it as a brand, the national media largely focuses on the camera-friendly Black Lives Matter movement, which is how Seals ended up falsely being labeled a member of Black Lives Matter after he was killed. What Seals fought for? Seals' forthrightness on the issue was and remains rare. If you are a Black U.S. citizen fighting for Black rights, you are the underdog. Up against a white supremacist system in which brutality toward Blacks is legitimized and practiced, especially by police. To expose internal fractures can appear to make the overall movement vulnerable, as it seems to play into the hands of white, right-wing movements longing for the Black rights movement to collapse. This power imbalance, combined with reluctance to criticize other Black activists ostensibly fighting for the same broader goal, has made many who share Seals' view wary of speaking them for fear of causing offense. Seals never cared if he offended. His blunt assertions that the movement had been hijacked by out-of-town activists and NGOs, as well as misogynist and homophobic comments about other Black protesters, offended many. But his views on the movement co-option were also embraced by many, particularly as local activists from Baton Rouge, Milwaukee, Baltimore, and other cities where a mass protest arose in reaction to police brutality began to express the same critiques. This is our city, our struggle, and we already have groups who have been fighting this struggle for years, they noted, balking at the sudden arrival of celebrity activists and NGOs who had ignored their day-to-day plight until the cameras arrived. Cameras were never Seals' concern. The streets of St. Louis were St. Louis, Louisians had known Seals since August 9, 2014, the day Mike Brown was killed by Officer Darren Wilson in Ferguson. They knew him for confronting cops like police union official Jeff Rota, who flaunted his I Am Darren Wilson bracelet shortly after Brown's death, and for condemning the out-of-town protesters who, thanks to media exposure, became the voices of a movement they did not start. On one infamous occasion in early 2015, Seals slapped D. Ray McKesson, a Minneapolis-based school administrator who arrived in Ferguson over a week after the protests began, but became the face of Ferguson coverage, landing a New York Times Magazine cover applauding his efforts in May 2015. Seals accused McKesson, who had been then long left St. Louis behind, of hijacking the Ferguson movement and neglecting the cash-strapped local activist still being targeted, jailed, and fined by the police. After the slap heard around St. Louis, both activists continued to fight for black rights, but in very different ways. McKesson went on to meet with elites in Aspen and D.C. and unsuccessfully run for mayor of Baltimore. Seals went back to his job in the General Motors assembly line and tried to raise money for underprivileged black children in St. Louis. Many disapproved of Seals' physical aggression or choice of McKesson as a target, but few in the Ferguson movement did not understand the pain behind it. The pain of living in a region overexposed and ignored at the same time. The pain of black death turned into business as Seals sighed. Who Seals was. St. Louis is a sprawling metropolis that feels like a small town because many tend to know someone who has been murdered or know their relatives or friends. Our connections are solidified in bereavement, and it is painful to write of Darren Seals as yet another name on the long list of people who left us too soon. Seals was not my friend, but he was an acquaintance. I met him a few times at protests. We followed each other on Twitter, and we shared close mutual friends. One of those friends is BG Real, a St. Louis writer who works in the hip-hop industry. On September 6th, it was my friend Umar Lee, who also covered the protest in Ferguson, when B-Girl sent me a text. "Someone killed Darren Seals last night," she wrote. I read the text out loud. "It's fucking St. Louis," Umar said, shaking his head at yet another violent death, another voice silence, and the horrifying familiarity of it all. Another of my friends, upon hearing about Seals, summed it up. "St. Louis is not where people live, it's where we wait to die." But there was a deeper point in Umar's simple statement. St. Louis is not a place to be trifled with. If you try to ignore its political reality, and St. Louis will rise up to remind you, with its anger, with its blood, haunting hypocrites like a ghost. St. Louis was what Darren Seals emphasized over and over until the day he died, no matter how badly some wanted him to stop. He documented St. Louis's hopes and hijacking, along with B-Girl and other black St. Louisians frustrated that a select group of Ferguson protesters, whom B-Girl and Seals called activists, had left St. Louis to travel the country giving talks and working for NGOs and making money, while the vast majority of local protesters were in jail, facing court dates, losing jobs, borderline homeless, or actually homeless. People accused Seals of being jealous, but he was not. He was angry. He wanted a black-run, self-determined movement rooted in local St. Louis concerns. He did not long for validation from white elites. He was furious at the exploitation of his community by outsiders for profit and fiercely protective of the Brown family. The Ferguson protests prompted a lot of national talk, but little real local reform. Black residents continued to be killed by police without repercussions, and majority black areas of the region remained disproportionately poor and strapped for resources. According to Seals, the media bonanza opened the door for others to capitalize on the Ferguson brand, to make black death a business. All over the country, organizations held panel discussions on Ferguson, but they rarely included anyone from St. Louis, and almost never black men who grew up poor and lacked a college education, despite that it was men like this who stood up to fight for Mike Brown from day one. And it was in Seals' arms that Mike Brown's mother wept.
Wow, let me stop there. Wow. I mean, wow. I mean, you read a good portion of the article, and as you read it, I mean, you can feel the realism in what this person was saying about Brother Seals. He was a sincere soldier. He was a person who cared about his people, who cared about the community, who saw through the phony fakeness of these black elitists who are nothing but porch monkeys for the wealthy 90% that's controlling 90%, that's controlling 90% of the wealth in this country. Mm-hmm. The 1% that's controlling 90% of the wealth in this country. He saw through what they were doing. And you know what? This is going on every day in the Democratic Party. This is going on every day in the Liberal Party. And you know what? The conservatives can't speak because, you know what? They just more out front with their racism, whereas the Democratic Party is more snake-like. The Democratic Party are more like snakes, and they're phony and fake with theirs. And what's funny is that you got educated black people who are easily used by politicians, by political officials, by law enforcement, who are willing to sacrifice their people. That's the modern day house Negroes that Malcolm X spoke about. And I'm pretty sure this is the reason why when I played that snippet of Brother Darren Seals, his voice talking about how he felt about the movement, and how he said how dare they compare D. Ray to Malcolm X. Mm-hmm. You can hear that angered him. How you gonna compare this house Negro, so many words, to Brother Malcolm X? Brother Malcolm, because that's who Darren Seals represented. Darren Seals represented Malcolm X. Darren Seals was a modern day Malcolm X, just like Tupac was a modern day Malcolm X. And that's what intimidates these white devils and these porch monkey Negroes. But you know what? They can't get rid of the voice.
No.
They can't get rid of the voice of the spirit of the great mother, the spirit of our ancestors that speak through us, because the voice that spoke through Darren Seals, the voice that spoke through Malcolm X and Tupac, was the voice of our ancestors, the warrior's voice of our ancestors. They can't silence that. It ain't going nowhere. There's always going to be somebody else that's going to step up to the plate.
Yep.
And so, you know, on that note, wow. I mean, I'm listening to you read in this way. As you was reading this, Queen was like, just tugging at my heart, because I can hear the truth in this article. I mean, this is a very truthful article, very in-depth article. Would you agree?
It is very.
And so,
as well as personal.
Yeah. Very personal. Very personal. You know, and so on that note, let me play another snippet of Brother Darren Seals, his personal words about how he felt about the movement. And, you know, we shall continue from there.
Now they on to the next city, then the next city, then the next city, then the next city, being superstars off our shit we created here. While we sitting back still like, damn, what we gonna do? Then after Mike Brown, it was Kajin Powell, then you had Von Derrick Myers, and so on and so on and so on. Cops ain't stopped killing her since Mike Brown died. And what Black Lives Matter doing about it? They just collecting checks. I ain't heard of them paying for no funerals. I ain't heard of them starting no programs for the youth, building no centers, nothing. You know what I mean? So we back at square one, back where we started. No justice, no nothing. And the biggest problem is, it's a lot of local people that sold out. Cause they wanted that GoFundMe money. They wanted that grant money. It was all about money to them, man. When I went out there, man, like I told them from day one, I already got money. Like, you know what I mean? I got a great job. I got money saved up. I'm investing in businesses. I already had my paper straight before I got out there. So it was never about no money with me, because I already got money. You can't buy my soul, my nigga. Like, I had money. I've been having money for years, man. I came from the streets. I know how to get money. I don't need to use Mike Brown to get no goddamn money. And that's why to this day, his dad still fuck with me. His dad called me. Matter of fact, I talked to Mike Brown Sr. 2 days ago. He wanted me to do something for him and his wife. And we just had a round table meeting with all the police chiefs. You know, I'm cursing their ass. I was snapping on them. And me and Mike Brown, you know, we talked about it. We like, man, you see, now that the media circus is over, who's still by your side? Who's still with you in this war? Now that you need somebody to be there and talk with you, because Mike Brown ain't, he a soldier. Like, he one of the realest dudes, because A lot of people don't give a fuck about their kids dying. A lot of these men ain't stepping up. You see the mothers in the media, but you don't see the fathers. But Mike Brown, he's still tall. So I respect that man. But at the same time, he ain't signed up for this. So he don't really know all of this to know about racism and the system of how it works. So he be needing cats like me, cats that's really educated on it, to come there and highlight these motherfuckers for him. You know what I mean? And stand tall with them. How they do. When they kill us, they stand with each other. But now that the media gone, where everybody at? You know what I mean? So this Black Lives Matter shit, man. Y'all gotta do some research on these people and find out who they are, what they've done, and all the motherfucking checks they collected. Google just gave these motherfuckers $500,000. I kid you not. You can look it up right now. Where that money go? Who benefited from this besides them? And I got paper. I don't need no paper. I ain't put a GoFundMe up and put no money in my pocket yet. I ain't took no grant money. I ain't joined no orgs, all these fucking punk ass orgs. What the fuck y'all doing? Y'all getting paid. And don't think I don't know about you niggas out there. All you niggas in these orgs getting paid 5-10 grand a month, traveling the fucking world, speaking like y'all fucking helping the community, ain't doing shit for the community. You sell out motherfuckers. Y'all don't want, y'all made these motherfuckers into who they are. We got blood, sweat, and tears in the streets for nothing. People risk their lives. People lost their jobs, lost their homes. Cats in prison right now doing 5-10 years behind Mike Brown. This Mike Brown shit. This shit was real. And all you niggas wanted was a couple dollars. We could have changed the fucking world. All you wanted was a fucking donation and a fucking a couple Twitter followers. You niggas is pussies.
There you go, brother Darren Seals. Warrior, soldier, revolutionary brother. I should keep that, brother. Brother gonna always be honored by me. Oh my God, look at you. He called them niggas pussies. He called them sold out pussies. All of them. They are. D-Ray, all of them. Even though D-Ray gonna, you know, try to say so-called pay his respects, he's still a house nigga.
Yep.
Yeah. The broads who founded Black Lives Matter. Bunch of elitist house negroes. How dare you go around under the cover that you care through protests when you got your own personal agenda? Now, mind you, they got a wonderful website with a whole manifesto of things that they're asking for the government that's supposed to be in, that, you know, that's supposed to represent the community.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, matter of fact, let me go to this. You know, I'm not sure if you got it, Queen, right there where it says 2016 Black Lives Matter agenda and platform. Yeah, right there. You bring that up right there, and you can see the manifesto. But you know what? A manifesto. I mean, Black Panther Party had a manifesto that was supposed to be a platform for the benefit of the Black community. Did the government recognize it? Did they honor it? Did they respect it? No. And these brothers in the Black Panther Party was real.
Yep.
They were real. They weren't playing. These brothers wasn't joking. They were about educating the community. What the hell, Black Lives Matter? They ain't educating the community. They're not teaching the community the legal system and their legal rights. They're not going around and, like you said, they're not paying for funerals. They're not doing what they can't do. I mean, why don't they hire all the money that they've gotten? Why don't they hire an investigator to find out what happened to Brother Darren Seals? Why don't they do that? They got the money. What do you say? Uber gave them 500 G's?
I say Google.
He said who?
I thought he said good.
He either said one of the corporations just gave, and then Ford gave them I think $1 million.
That's crazy. And what are they doing?
No, Ford gave them $100 million. They got $100 million from Ford.
And what are they doing with it?
Good question. So far they look like a bunch of house Negro broads. You know, I don't care about them being gay. That's their own personal thing. But I'm talking about what they represent. They're a bunch of house porch monkey elitists. That's what it looked like to me. And obviously, that's how it looked to Brother Darren Seals as well. You feel me?
Because they haven't put back anything into the community that they used to platform their whole nonprofit organization. If they claim they were part of the Ferguson protests and they were trying to help the people in Ferguson, but they haven't done anything for anybody in Ferguson.
No, and you know what? Due to the fact that they are a national organization, mm-hmm. they haven't done nothing nowhere for any black community for that matter. You feel me?
Yeah.
You know, let alone the fact that they used Ferguson to help broaden their agenda and to help build popular, you know, basically bring popularity and media attention to their organization.
Mm-hmm.
They still, they haven't, I mean, they ain't did nothing for nobody but themselves. And, you know, due to the fact that what Brother Darren Seals was talking about, I got some information. You know what? But let's check out this platform right quick.
Okay.
What they're asking for. If you go down, if you go down to the bottom, it says demands.
Yeah, they have a list of demands. It says end the war on black people, reparations, invest, divest, economic justice.
Yeah, and if you click on it, it goes into detail about what they're asking for.
So they have community control, political power. And so, yeah, they have their list of demands on their little Black Lives Matter movement for Black Lives.
Yeah, now if you go a little, if you go down farther down the list of information that I got, this is the question. Like I say, all this money that they're bringing in, where is it going? I got two articles right here. One is called Black Lives Matter Leaders Duke It Out Over Disappearing Charity Money.
Then
and another one, where did all the money Sean King raised for Black Matters go? Sean King was a part of Black Lives Matter. He was another member of the organization. He was actually, I believe, a fundraiser part of their organ. He helped fundraise for them.
Uh-huh.
And he brought in hundreds of thousands and millions of dollars. And the money can't account for it. You know, can't account for it. So you go ahead, but let's read a little bit of that right there. Any of those. Read any of those, Queen, so we can, like, you know, substantiate with Brother, you know.
This is an article from the Daily Beast. Where did all the money Sean King raised for Black Lives go? Written by Goldie Taylor. On December 15, 2015. The most prominent face of the movement needs to explain how he spent millions he raised for causes from Haiti to racial justice across America. Sean King... Hold on a second, my page jumped. Sean King is very good at raising money in support of black lives, and one of those lives might be his own. King, one of the most visible faces of the Black Lives Matter movement, and no stranger to controversy, is now beating back accusations that he has misappropriated or mismanaged charitable funds. King collected millions of dollars for everyone from Haitian orphans to the families of black men and children killed by police across America. Some of that money went to survivors of victims' families, but much of the largest either went into failed projects, King's own pockets, or is unaccounted for. It's just bullshit, King told the Daily Beast on Tuesday after allegations were lobbied against him by members of his own movement. People need to understand that failure is not fraud. The former mega church pastor turned citizen journalist has leveraged heavy doses of charisma into 218,000 Twitter followers and a column at the New York Daily, the New York Daily News, to chronicle instances of suspected injustices carried out by police in predominantly non-white communities. King counts a flurry of A-list celebrities and largely left-leaning politicians among his most ardent fans. They follow his Twitter timeline for the latest news, whether it's a video of a cop shooting an unarmed black boy or a school resource officer accused of brutalizing a teenager. Like so many others, I know, King only through the lens of social media. I have watched him grow in prominence and struggle to balance that newfound fame. There is nothing inevitable about the white-hot glare of those who are devoted to your personal destruction on a daily basis. His focus on race and inequality has earned him the wrath of conservative bloggers and Fox News anchor Bill O'Reilly. I have at times defended him against some of the most vicious assaults, and at others pulled his coattail when I thought some counsel could help. To be honest, I've long been aware of the suspicions some harbor about how he managed charitable donations. I've groused privately about the the veracity of some of his reporting and whether his body of writing met to the publishing standards that so many in this business work under. I heard the whispers, the backroom talk from people who did not want to see as to be seen as racist or acting like crabs in the barrel for criticizing King. What I do think about Sean King. What do you think about Sean King? The conversation almost invariably opens. I want to be fair, I generally respond. People haven't always been fair to me. Certainly King is sometimes the first to break a story nationally and a mention in this in his timeline all but guarantees that a cable news producer will see it. All too often, he is the only voice in the discourse that refuses to let go when the news cameras have picked up and gone home. And no one else is left to care but a grieving family and its lawyers. It's his dog approach to following the minute of any given case has netted him a reputation for being vigilant, even if the early facts, as he spells them out, later fall apart.
Wow, wow, wow. Let me stop you right there, because I know this list goes on. But because the thing that got me is finding out that he was a pastor of a church.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's where you also handle a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
Also, him being a pastor of a church and then coming in and handling the fundraising part of Black Lives Matter. I mean, come on. That was like a perfect fit for him. Because what do a pastor do? A pastor talks. I mean, a pastor is all about it's all about his style and his finesse. It's all about knowing how to articulate yourself to draw attention.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously he was good at that. Okay. He was obviously good at that. But if you continue on, let me see, I will continue from here because it goes on to say, it talks about him being in 2009, the Morehouse College graduate and Oprah Winfrey scholar said that he raised $1 million and organized 10,000 volunteers for flood relief in Atlanta. Months later, in 2010, after a whirlwind of positive media coverage, King says he put his passion and power and prowess to work again after a devastating series of earthquakes in Haiti. Hades killed more than 200,000 people and left a million more homeless. And, you know, I want people to know that there was a whole lot of money being misappropriated, missing money, disappearing money, that was money that was supposed to go to the Haitian people and help them rebuild their homes, help them fix their water so they can have clean water. And a lot of that money did not go to where it was supposed to go. It did not go to the people of Haiti. And so obviously he was a part of that circle. It says his tweet change, a web auction house funded by King raised, it was called Tweet Change, a web auction house funded by King raised over $1 million in support of a home in Hades. According to Forbes, some of the reported intake estimated stretched to $2 million, the relief fund, which was never incorporated or registered as an independent nonprofit, brought in over $100,000 in its first 24 hours, according to King, with actress Eva Longoria serving as his chief. Eva Longoria serving as his chief spokesperson. A Hominian Haiti. How you pronounce that?
I don't know where you are.
Yeah, right here it says Eva Longoria serving as a chief spokesperson, and then it continues.
You've skipped down. I don't know where you are. You didn't.
Okay. They said they were collecting funds to build an orphanage in Banu, Haiti. The Miriam Center is a part of the Christian mission that serves children with special needs in the Caribbean nation. It reported that only 540,000 was actually raised, far short of the $1 million that King publicly proclaimed.
and said that it ultimately only received a grant of $200,000. So basically, if there was more money, where did it go? Why would he talk about money he didn't actually raise? You know, and then when we come to find out, when they dig deep and find out, well, did they get this money? They didn't get all the money that he claiming that they raised. Either he's lying about how much money he's raising, or he's pocketing part of that money. So, yeah. But you know, let me not focus in on King. My purpose of talking about King is to substantiate what Brother Darren Seals was trying to expose, that there was a lot of corruption going on in these so-called nonprofit organizations, these NGOs. And Black Lives Matter is a part of that. Sean King worked for Black Lives Matter. He was a part of their organization. He was a part of their fundraising organization. And so right now he's caught up in a flurry of fund corruption, of misappropriating funds. Also, there's another article right here I want to read before we leave the air. Black Lives Matter leaders duke it out over disappearing charity money. You see that one, Queen?
Hold on.
I'll read this one right here. Let me know when you got it. So, but you know, Brother Darren Seals was a soldier. I can never say that too many times, you know. You don't find activists that remind you of other activists like Malcolm X and brothers who are soldiers for the cause. You don't find them every day. And that brother was one of them. But this is an article right here that was taken from, it's called hotair.com, which is a journalistic site. And the title is, the title of this is called Black Lives Matter. Leaders duke it out over disappearing charity money. Are there cracks appearing in the far-flung leadership of the Black Lives Matter movement? One might imagine that inside any desperate political organization, disputes will eventually arise over the message, the strategy, priorities, or any of several key management issues. The same thing happened to the Occupy movement when they were unable to reach a consensus of twinkles on who was supposed to clean up the rape tents in New York City. Let me read that again. It says, the same thing happened to the Occupy movement when they were unable to reach a consensus of uptwinkle on who was supposed to clean up the rape tents in the New York City. The organization never really recovered. Yesterday on Twitter, a policy fight broke out between two prominent Black Lives Matter activists, both of whom are likely familiar to readers. The Daily Caller picked up on the spat and captured some of the tense moments between D. Ray McKinson and current New York Daily News writer Sean King. But it wasn't the normal debate over where to hold the next protest. What the banners should read are which cops to condemn to life of unemployment. This particular argument had to do with a nonprofit organization which King had started, where D. Ray sat on the board, and what happened to the money they raised. A massive gift appeared Sunday in the Black Lives Matter movement when two of its most high profile activists went at it on Twitter. The beef appears to center on New York City Daily News columnist Sean King's defunct social justice charity, Justice Together. D. Ray McKenzie, a prominent grassroots activist who sat on Justice Together board of the directors, took King to ask for blocking him on Twitter when he asked about the group's planning and financing. Following a Daily Caller exposed last month, King announced that he was shutting down Justice Together and another similar group he founded last year called Justice That's All. So, I mean,
I don't want to read too much of this article because this is, I don't like the way it's ranting, but just talking about them two arguing about money. I mean, all that sounds very suspect. You feel me? It sounds very suspect. Yet, Black Lives Matter have gotten not only a lot of media attention, but it's gotten a lot of backing by a lot of grassroots black organizations, black churches, and just black people in general who supported them due to all the media attention that the organization got due to the protests that were all over the country exposing police brutality. But like Brother Darren Seal said, with all this attention came a lot of money and a lot of fundraising. And in the process, where did the money go? Because they're not spending it on causes that they claim that they're standing up for. Meaning causes that's supposed to represent the black community, that's supposed to educate the black community, that's supposed to help the black community. They're not spending millions of dollars. It's not going to the black community.
That's my person.
No. So, you know, things look very suspect. You feel me? Very much suspect. But all in all, it just shows me who was the real leader. The real leader was the underdog. The real leader was Brother Darren Seals, revolutionary soldier and activist, our brother, a fallen soldier, somebody to admire, to aspire to look up to, and to honor. May he rest in peace as he walked with our ancestors. Brother Darren Seals, much love to his family. And so, you know, on that note, I gotta go. We gotta go. Let me also say, again, let me promote anybody who, you know, because, you know, Kwanzaa's around the corner, you know. So please shop at our online store, Mystic Roots, which is www.mysticroots.yourafricanmarket.com, where you can buy all your African gifts, cosmetics, and so forth. Please check us out there. And also, due to the fact that my show expenditure, you know, it costs money to stay on the air. It's not free. And so on that note, I'm trying to keep things together as far as keeping, you know, I gotta pay for these things. It is, you know, I wish it was free to do a show on the air, because if it was free to do a show on the air, then I wouldn't have to be, you know, have a GoFundMe. I got a GoFundMe.
GoFundMe.
So if anybody want to donate to the Black Village and help keep what I do, spreading truth to the conscious community, dropping the Ron Uncut to the conscious community, because I love doing what I do. I love bringing truth to the conscious community. I love sharing. You can always join. Yeah, let me also say this. You can always join the show. Doesn't cost you a dime. Just a bit of your conscious time. Please join the show. Doesn't, you know, at 855-445-9340. You also can chime in at 857-232-0155. And don't forget the conference key to get through the conference door, which is 947-595. But even my toll-free number, it might be free to the community, but it ain't free to me. So that cost, that's an expenditure. I can't even say that.
It's
right.
An expense.
It's an expense. There you go. Yeah, it's an expense. So, you know, so I would like for anybody that, you know, I'm not in the business of I don't like asking anybody for nothing. But if anybody would like to donate to the Black Village Community Podcast, to help keep us on the air. So if anybody would like to donate to what I do and help keep me on the air, help pay for these expenses, it is GoFundMe.com/the-Black Village-podcast-donation. Please do. Please, whatever, $1, $2, $3, I don't care. You know, I'm just looking to help pay the expenses to keep me on the air and to help, you know, because, you know, at the end of the day, You know, actually this year wasn't that, you know, it wasn't that easy for me. So, you know, but I will do what I got to do to try to keep myself on the air. So whatever anybody give, I appreciate it. Coming from the heart, thank you very much. Much love. And so on that note, we got to get out of here. Queen, any last words before we head out of here? Queen.
You know, for one fallen hero dies, we need to make sure the next one is able to rise up to be his voice be heard again. The next one could be one of our sons. We need to make sure that as a community and to be one and united, that we can stop this tragedy from continuing. You know, for what it's worth, that black folks need to remember that our government system isn't set up for us. And it is time for us to take action to have our human rights restored. Because we cannot gain our civil rights if our human rights aren't recognized.
I totally agree with my queen on that note. And what I would say in last words is, you know, I pray the strength, I pray the love, and I pray the peace for Darren Seal's family, his mother, his brother, and anyone that he's personally left behind. I pray for their strength and for their love and for their peace. And I thank the great mother for bringing that brother here. It was a brother was a wonderful brother from what I, you know, from video footage that I've seen, audio cast that I've heard and video that I've seen and things that he's wrote on the internet to help, you know, bring light to subject matters, his stance on the issues. He was a brother who truly cared about his people. You feel me? And he just didn't like the phoniness. He didn't like the fakeness. He didn't like what he was seeing, the corruption, you know? And so got number love and respect for that brother. You feel me? So on that note, I got to go. You know, I will be back next Delicious Black Sunday, dropping nothing but the raw and uncut here on the Black Village Community Podcast. And, you know, as always, as I always say, you know, may the great mother bring us together under the wings of her love, of her peace. And I love chicken, so love, peace, and chicken grease. I gotta go. I'm out of here. I'm finna end the show with Brother Darren Seal's rapping with the group DOA called Target. Born Target. So please, you know, check it out. You can go check it out on YouTube. So I'm ending the show on the note with Brother Darren Seals. Much love, peace, I'm out.
Receiving blessings from the Most High, cause I survived the test when most died. This ain't no ACT. My safety release. We didn't pray for the peace for generations. Face it, it's time a nigga take what he seek. I loaded up my frustration and head straight to the streets. I done yelled some vocal statements in the face of the beast. See wounded soldiers, I'm pacing back and I'm saving them each. No explanation, they threw my niggas in cages for weeks. As they hide behind a shield, but that won't stop you from catching a bullet while driving. As you die behind the wheel, are you trying to get killed? Man, it can happen live on national news and you gon' lie about it still. So, fuck authority, just a voice of majority. Joining forces and stick a fork in the system. You're forcing me to take some type of action. Ho, we shutting it down. It's DOA versus the government. Come fuck with us now.
I used to serve them fiends well with them quarters and blocks. Now my message reached them youngins on the corners and blocks. Cops lurching, head hunting, black youth in the murder. Made us gangsters, then they haters. Changed our views, now they scared of us. Michael Brown, Kerry Ball, yeah, they living through me. So if the law's got a problem, tell them bitches sue me. We was marching hands up, not concerning the cops. Next thing you know, them bitches start pointing they choppers. They wanted to trip quick and start turning it up. So that fucking quick trip, we got them burning it up. Now it's a fire in the middle of the mouth. They the ones spark that violence. Got my niggas riding strapped. Whole team full of riders. And we tired like on the back. Some of the fuck been silent. We the loudest on these tracks. They called me D-Boy when I was whipping up that rock. Now it's King D. Seals, but I'm still screaming fuck the cops.
If you don't, if it
rock.